Yesterday, I caught up with the State Bank of India Chairman Rajnish Kumar. The topic of the day, of course, was farm loans, and Rajnish Kumar was quite clearly batting for the Telangana variety of direct income support to farmers and not farm loan waiver, since it destroys the long-term credit culture. He also said that in many cases, farmers' income is not enough to support debt, and therefore supplementing income is better than waiving loans. Just listen, it's an interesting conversation where he also speaks about a dramatic improvement in cost to income because of digitization.
One, this is not a permanent solution. It has not helped in the past, it will not help in future.
Okay.
The fact is also that many a times the farmer's income cannot support the debt which they are taking, because income is low. Then whether we focus on augmenting that income or we take the route of loan waivers. So better and preferable way
will be
boosting up the investment in the agriculture, and in what manner can we support the farmers to be productive.
No, that's
Indian
a great
agriculture
point.
Productivity is so poor in India, and then on the top of it, if you burden the farmers with the debt, so how do they pay even if they have the intention to pay?
So this Raitu Bandhu in Telangana is
I would consider it to be a much better option than loan waivers. It does put a certain fiscal burden on the state, but both puts.
Yes,
but
sir, waiver also
debt, the Telangana model, from banker's perspective or from whatever way you look at it, I think it is a much better way of assisting the farmers rather than
loan
waivers.
Okay. Now, two quick questions on loan waiver itself from the banker's point of view. You know, in Maharashtra, it took very long to identify the borrower. Has it now at least...
Things are much more
underway,
stable, because the difference between Maharashtra and other state, like say for UP government, was that here the Maharashtra government decided to waive the loans even for higher amounts. But above a cutoff, say 150,000, the farmers were required to pay, and the relief was limited to 150.
Okay.
Whereas in UP, the scheme was very simple, that up to 1 lakh and you get the relief.
Okay.
So that's why implementation was easier, and that is where, like, even if any loan waiver or anything, the things have to be kept simple, and probably then the implementation will be much better, because the idea is that once the loan is paid off, then the farmer should be able to avail the loan immediately. But as I'm saying, that if the fundamental issue of agricultural productivity is not addressed, we will continue to have this situation.
The farm loan waiver, which has just been announced, Madhya Pradesh, and which will be announced in Chhattisgarh, are these loans already bad? And therefore, for you, it is an advantage because it will get paid by the government sometime, you know.
It is a short-term
advantage. Is that the way it will
work? It is a short-term advantage.
Or are they now standard loans which will become NPL?
No.
What is the situation now?
No. Whatever it is, that in the short term, immediately, because the NPA gets paid, so to that extent, you see a better NPA
recovery.
But after that, the problem again starts, and again the NPAs goes up. So agriculture NPA from 2010 onwards, they have gone up.
Okay. So that is why the answer really lies
in the boosting the income. Because unless there are two things in any credit, whether it is agriculture, business, corporate, anybody. One is the intent to pay.
Yes.
And second is capability to pay.
Okay.
So I would say that the common man's intent to pay is much better in India.
Okay.
So there is absolutely no doubt about it.
And we should not destroy it.
We should not destroy it. Okay. The intent to pay should not be destroyed. Capability to pay and alignment of the debt servicing capability with their income, that is where a permanent solution will be formed.
Okay, that's a strong call for income support rather than loan waivers, asking the political economy. But we spoke at length about SBI's numbers also, and Rajnish Kumar was very confident SBI's digital push, as well as lower provisioning and higher loan growth, will be able to bring down their cost to income ratio to 40%. In fact, he says that that target is for FY21, but by FY20, they should be able to bring it down to 45%. Listen.
On YONO, we are sending the pop-up for pre-approved personal loans. And that is instantly available.
Okay.
Similarly, loans against, say, fixed deposits.
Okay.
So one doesn't have to go to the branch either to open a fixed deposit or to get a loan. Okay. It can be done on the digital platform. Same is now we are building journeys around home loan, car loan, education loan, salary loans. So what, as I have said, that the vision is that within 2 years' time from now, we have already spent 2 years, and 2 years more, it will be a complete bank. All the processes will be digitized and available on YONO.
Are you seeing a lot of your retail guys not coming to branch at all? I mean, will you go to the extent of penalizing them if they come to branch?
No, not at all.
Okay.
So our philosophy is that it is customer's convenience.
Okay.
Whatever is their comfort level, if they want to come
like
to the branch.
Many of us would not have gone to a branch in a very long time because you can pay all your bills on the net.
Everything. So you don't need it, but still there is, as I said, that Visa.
You're seeing that transition.
But still there are the footfalls in SBI are very high.
Okay.
Because the customer segment we serve, so it is across.
Yes.
So there is a certain set of segments, customer segment who will not come to the branch and will be all using internet banking or mobile banking.
Yeah.
But there is a segment of customers who still come to the branches.
Yes,
so
yes.
That's what I said, that for a bank like State Bank of India, where we are catering to the customer segment underprivileged to the,
I would say,
richest. So in that scenario, all are needed. There are many people who are not comfortable
all are needed.
With mobile banking, not comfortable with even debit card or ATM card. So we have to take care of those.
I can
also
imagine if my father were alive, he would not have been able to
exactly.
do it. He would still have gone to the branch to get his pension or whatever. But what about cost savings in terms of any number? For instance, this by the end of this year itself, will you see it reflected in a lower cost to income? I think now cost to income is getting higher because of provisioning. But do you think by, say, FY20, you can
maybe March, say by March 21,
our you can distinctly see cost to income.
Our internal target is we should be able to bring it down to 40%. But that is a bit, I would say, ambitious,
I mean,
but not entirely impossible. And that will be, of course, driven by one is definitely the revenue growth is very much there. It is back. There is a complete control over the cost. Plus the digital, and it is digitization is not about YONO or front-end application. Even all the branch processes are getting digitized. It is some sort of an omni-channel experience where whether it is on the mobile or portal or the branch, experience will be identical.
Okay, that's the word coming in from the nation's biggest bank.